Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Good evening. Welcome to another episode of Centering on Peace. My name is Farmers Farbod. I'm your host tonight. And my guest tonight is Joseph Gerson. He is a person who has been interested and concerned about nuclear weapons and the arms race for a very long time. He's the president of Campaign for Peace and Common Security. He works with a lot of peace movements in Asia and Europe. He's been also the past director of programs of the American Friends Service Committee, author of 4 books, 2 of which I have with me. I can show you on the screen, With Hiroshima Eyes. This is from 1995. I purchased it probably in 1996, and I read it back then in the late 90s. This is a 2007 book, Empire and the Bomb. And subtitle is How the U.S. Uses Nuclear Weapons to Dominate the World. Joseph is also author of a couple of other books, The Sun Never Sets and Deadly Connections. I don't know the dates of those books. Maybe the first question I'll ask you is like, when did you write those two books, The Sun Never Sets and The Deadly Connection, Joseph?
I have to see if I can remember. I think The Deadly Connection was about 1983 or 84, mm-hmm. and The Sun Never Sets was about 1991 or so.
Okay.
Ancient history.
Okay. Thanks for that. So I guess the best way for us to begin is to get our audience to get to know you a little bit better. And my first question would be to tell us about the trajectory of your life leading you in the direction of being who you are and being a researcher and a campaigner for peace in relation to nuclear weapons and nuclear armaments.
So I'm a child of the Judeo side. I was born in 1946, Jewish, and the lessons that my parents inculcated in me were never against anyone, which means anyone. Never to participate in the crime of silence, which means turning your head away from injustice and not addressing it, and that there's a causal relationship between the pursuit of truth or the practice of lies to who lives, who dies, and how. And so that led me, as a high school student, into the margins of the civil rights movement. I went off to Georgetown University School of Foreign Service in 1964, not understanding the clash between my goals. On the one hand, I wanted to be a freedom rider in the civil rights movement. And on the other hand, I guess inspired by President Kennedy, wanting to be a diplomat for the U.S. Mm-hmm. But after being there not so long and learning more about the Vietnam War, I learned that I couldn't be a diplomat for the U.S. and be consistent with my values. But I finished my education there, was involved in the Poor People's Campaign, the original one, and early anti-war Vietnam activities. I was in Chicago for the 1968 Democratic Convention in the streets and witnessed, it was not a police riot. It was a very disciplined assault by a police state. And I ended up getting draft counsel there, being trained as a draft counselor. I ended up in Arizona, of all places, from 69 to 73, as the lead anti-war organizer, draft counselor, became a draft resister. And with the Paris Peace Accords, and we thought the war was over, I was invited to join the staff of the War Resisters International in London. And then we moved to Brussels. So I had this extraordinary set of privileges, working with World War I conscientious objectors, with a woman who could remember taking Prince Kropotkin back to the train station in a carriage, with people involved in the nonviolent and violent resistance to Nazi occupations, and with the people who later became the leaders of the European nuclear disarmament movement. Along the way, I dug in the U.S. back in those days, there was almost no literature, meaningful literature, about the history and politics of the Middle East. But with Britain's colonial oppression, one of the results of that was just massive amounts of good literature in Britain about the Middle East. So I dug in. 1975, I was invited to join a National Council of Churches fact-finding delegation to the region. We arrived in Beirut 15 minutes before the Civil War started. And that led me ultimately to joining the American Friends Service Committee as a Middle East coordinator, which I did for a number of years. And in 19, I helped launch the Freeze Movement. We can talk about that later. But in 1983, we learned that Senator Kennedy had been suckered in by President Reagan in an effort to try to turn Boston Harbor into a nuclear weapons base. And I was aware of ways that that would violate the freeze. Kennedy had been a lead supporter of the freeze, the dangers of nuclear weapons accidents, and just what an awful thing this was. And so with friends, I led the organizing that blocked it. It didn't happen. This is a similar campaign in San Francisco, which kept these missiles from being deployed. And that in turn led to an invitation to go to Japan in the summer of 1984 for the World Conference Against NH Bombs. And there I worked closely with A-bomb survivors, met them, but also learned about the U.S.-Japan alliance and its being the foundation for a U.S. post-World War II imperialism in the region. And that just led to increasingly deep engagements, both with A-bomb survivors, but with peace scholars and peace activists from across Asia Pacific.
My understanding is that at that time, A-bomb survivors, even inside Japan, were shunned by the public and by politicians. And my guess is globally as well. So when you met them, it must have been very hard for them to open up to you, and must have been an experience for you that opened your eyes to the impact of such weaponry on people.
Yeah, so, you know, intellectually, I'd done the reading and I understood what nuclear weapons were and what they did. That I understood. By that time, we already knew about the danger of nuclear winter. By that time, I mean, even to this day, some A-bomb survivors hide their identity because they don't want to be discriminated against. And this has impacted, among other things, their marriages, because people have been afraid of their partner having mutations. But the history is that in 1954, as part of a series of nuclear weapons tests in the Marshall Islands, the United States detonated a hydrogen bomb 1,000 times more powerful than the Hiroshima A-bomb. I mean, that's beyond comprehension. And that irradiated a number of Marshall Islanders who on the island of Rongelap. Most of them died of cancer over time or other radiation diseases. I met some of the people who survived for a while. But it also irradiated Japanese fishermen, about 1,000 fishing boats, which in turn also meant a number of them dying, and also poisoning a major portion of Japan's food supply. And that in turn triggered, I'm just back from a commemoration for that, that in turn, there's some women in Tokyo who, as they're hearing stories about some of the fishermen coming back being sick with what appeared to be radiation disease, they put two and two together and made the connections to the Hiroshima and Nagasaki A-bombs, because the U.S. had tried to keep what had happened secret. I mean, much of this has been developed in secret. And they launched a petition campaign that garnered 31.5 million petition signatures and led to what was called the First World Conference Against A&H Bombs, which was the political leaders and others from across the country and internationally. Some Americans even went to the first one. Mm-hmm. Up to that time, for the most part, A-bomb survivors had remained hidden. They were, many of them were disfigured. There were public fears because people didn't know what the cause of these radiation diseases were. I mean, the U.S. had U.S. censorship during the military occupation had prohibited any serious studies. In fact, even the newspapers couldn't possess the kanji, the characters for atom and bomb. But with that first conference, there was one woman who was invited to speak. Took a lot of courage, and that, in a sense, opened up the public discourse enough that some A-bomb survivors could begin to come out. Mm-hmm. They began calling for an abolition of nuclear weapons, for preventing a possible nuclear war, for getting adequate care. The Japanese government provided no care for A-bomb victims. The next year they formed the organization called Nihon Nidankyo, the Confederation of A&H Bomb Sufferers Organizations. And although it's been a minority of them, they have been at the core of international campaigning for the abolition of nuclear weapons. I mean, many of them still scarred. I mean, those who survived, still scarred, you know, they've died of cancer over the years, other radiation diseases. But they've turned, some of these people have turned these profound psychological, emotional, and physical scars into what Wilfred Burchett, the first Western journalist who went to Hiroshima after the A-bombing, into what he called the most powerful force for the abolition of nuclear weapons. We had in 2017, the negotiation of an international treaty, the Treaty on Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. And that grew in large measure out of their testimonies about what nuclear weapons do, their belief that human beings and nuclear weapons cannot coexist. And it's worth noting that they are not the only A-bomb survivors. Every country that has developed nuclear weapons has tested them. And as a result, we have additional hibakusha, additional nuclear weapons victims, including here in the United States. You know, we've had campaigning for some time for medical care and compensation for the victims of the Trinity H-bomb, the one that was detonated in New Mexico before the Hiroshima A-bomb. And then there were a series of other, you know, atmospheric tests here in the United States, and even those in the Pacific that carried deadly radiation. But, you know, the Chinese, the Russians, the French, the British, they all have nuclear weapons, Indians, Pakistanis, nuclear weapons victims from those tests as well. I've been privileged to work with many of them.
Has the United States government ever assumed any responsibility for treatment of these people?
The only people that the U.S. has assumed some responsibility for are some of the downwinders, and now some of the atomic veterans. Atomic veteran, what does that mean? What it means is that after nuclear weapons tests, but rather purposefully, the Pentagon exposed soldiers and sailors to the radiation from the tests. You know, some of them I worked with had been in the Pacific, and they had the job of scrubbing down ships that had been used as targets. You can find film clips of a detonation of a small atomic bomb, maybe from a howitzer, and then you see U.S. troops who've been in trenches, jumping out of the trenches and marching into the area, which has just been irradiated. And of course, these people suffered cancers and all kinds of diseases. So you have really in the last several years, finally. Passage of legislation that provides some care. One woman I work with from Utah, the tests from the Nevada test, the underground test, they also leaked. And so you had radiation going over parts of Nevada. They only did it when the wind was blowing away from Las Vegas, up over Utah, and then across the country. I mean, Kodak was used to develop photographs from across the country. They would close down their operation in Rochester, New York. They had advanced notice that the radiation would be coming. So this one woman that I worked with, her father and father-in-law had been uranium miners. They died of cancer. Her sister died from fallout from the tests. Her daughter died from fallout from the tests. And she would take every night a line of pills about this long, simply to keep herself going. Some of these people are finally getting some care, but not. It's been a crime. I mean, a major crime.
The U.S. government has never taken any responsibility for the care of the atomic bombing survivors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, has they?
No, not at all. And interestingly, neither has, well, it took a huge fight in Japan to even get a minimum amount of medical care for some of the victims there. There's another long story there about kind of the evolution of the Japanese state, but that's probably not for now.
Mm-hmm. I see. Now, let me bring you a little bit closer to the 1980s in terms of your own biography. I remember the 70s as being kind of like a calm period because there was a nuclear parity between the United States and Soviet Union and not much consideration in terms of social movements for anti-nuclear weaponry. But when the United States decided in 1979, I think it was December of 1979, to re-equip Europe with Pershing and cruise missiles that were deemed to be first strike weapons, mm-hmm. it spawned a new movement, anti-nuclear movement, freeze movement. And you were part of that. So do you want to share a little bit of your background there?
Sure. So kind of in two ways. First of all, to say that, after the Paris Peace Accords were signed and people thought that had ended the Indochina War, mm-hmm. people were exhausted. The anti-war movement, progressive forces were exhausted from opposing the war for a number of years. I was in, with my work with War Resisters International in Europe, I was visiting friends and co-workers in Copenhagen in October of 73. That was at the time of the October War. Mm-hmm. There was a ceasefire in place, so we all thought the war was over. But when I woke up this morning in Copenhagen, the people I was with had been listening to Armed Forces Radio. And the Armed Forces Radio reported that the U.S. forces were on a nuclear alert. And I wonder, what is this about? I called friends back at home in the United States to see if Nixon, in the last stages of Watergate, was planning a military coup. They said no. What we learned later, actually, is the Secretary of Defense was afraid that Nixon might pull a coup and had issued an order that there would be no significant troop movements without his signed authorization. Mm-hmm. But what we learned later, was that Kissinger and Golda Meir had made a deal, and Golda Meir being the Prime Minister of Israel. And the Egyptian army had been defeated. There was a ceasefire and a ceasefire line in place. But with Kissinger's okay, the Israelis continued to move the ceasefire line. They kept pushing the Egyptian army. Not only did they push it, they encircled the Egyptian Third Army, denying it food and water. Mm-hmm. And so Sadat became very concerned that in addition to losing the war, he was going to lose this entire army. And so he signaled to Kissinger and to the Soviets. Nixon at that point was out of circulation, he's mostly drunk and from Watergate fears, and Kissinger was running U.S. policy. Sadat signaled that the next day he would go to the U.N. and urge U.S. and Soviet intervention to enforce the ceasefire and protect his troops. Well, Kissinger had been doing his best to structure the outcome of the war to maximize U.S. influence in the Middle East. And the last thing he wanted was the Soviets to be joining the U.S. in the post-war settlements. So he put U.S. troops on alert. as a way to signal the Russians to keep the hell out of there. And he called Golda and said, well, it's over. You've got to observe the ceasefire. So I learned this over time. And so I learned here the dangers of foreign imperialism, and of wars that could escalate. So then we'll jump ahead a little bit here.
Mm-hmm.
As you said, in 1979, we were facing the escalation of the arms race in Europe. On the one hand, the Russians were moving to deploy these huge SS-20 missiles that could wipe out European leadership quite quickly. And in response, the U.S. was moving to deploy Pershing 2 ICBMs and Tomahawk cruise missiles. Those would be in Italy primarily. And so we were moving, increasing. The Europeans were freaked. They were facing the possibility of the end of life in Europe. And there were growing demonstrations, big demonstrations in Europe. And there was a study group at MIT led by a former member of the, one of the scientists at the Manhattan Project that developed the A-bomb, with a number of doctoral students. And growing out of their discussions, a doctoral student named Randy Forsberg, came up with the idea of calling for a halt to the nuclear arms race. The idea was it would be frozen. These weapons wouldn't be deployed, and we wouldn't move closer to nuclear annihilation. It was not abolition, but it was a step.
Mm-hmm.
So there was that. The American Friends Service Committee that I worked for endorsed it, but nobody, Fellowship of Reconciliation endorsed it, but nobody knew quite what to do with it. And we had a meeting. I supervised programs across New England, and we had a planning meeting. And we were also facing budget cuts that year. And the organizer, a guy named David McCauley in Vermont, used an inappropriate segue to jump up and say that year they were going to get 15 town meetings to endorse the freeze, and that the next year there would be 175. Actually, this was following on a model out in your part of the world, Western Massachusetts, where a guy named Randy Keeler, who was the one who inspired Dan Ellsberg to release the Pentagon Papers. Hmm. He had done a couple of referendum out there against nuclear power plants. And he did one in 1980 in opposition, in support of the freeze, that won, even as Reagan was running some of those districts. So we had a model. And when Dave McCauley said he was going to do this, we all thought, well, Dave, that's a great way to save your job, but no way. I mean, it's beyond our imagination. Well, he did it. In fact, that town, that year, they had 17 towns vote for the freeze in Vermont. Mm-hmm. You had an op-ed article on the pages of the Times, which explained what this was and the hope that it provided. And the next year, you had 330 towns across New England and 8 states vote for a freeze. Mm-hmm. And with that, some of the Democratic politicians, including Ed Markey, now our senator, and then Senator Kennedy, jumped aboard, basically tried to capture the leadership of the freeze movement and advocated for it in Congress. You had the June 12th, 1982 nuclear disarmament protest in New York City. It's little remembered by successive generations, but we had about 1 million people in New York City. It was the biggest peace demonstration in U.S. history. And that, you had the pressures from the Europeans. You had the change of government in the Soviet Union with Gorbachev coming to power. Gorbachev understood both the dangers of nuclear war, of the arms race, but also he wanted to focus investment in trying to save the Soviet economy. Mm. So you had all kinds of activities taking place. You had exchanges back and forth, musicians, delegations. Encircling. You had these kind of hand-holding things across cities, calling for the freeze, and it forced Reagan to reverse course. And that you had also, as part of all these dynamics, Olof Palme, who was the prime minister of Sweden. again, seeing the danger here, pulled together very senior figures from the United States, including former Secretary of State Cyrus Vance, major figures in the Russian defense structure, senior European diplomats and scholars, how to stop this spiraling arms race. And they came up with the concept of common security, published it, basically its essence is that no nation can be secure if its rivals are not secure. You can only develop security with your rival. And so all those forces came together and led to the negotiation of the INF Treaty, the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty, that banned the deployment of the Pershing 2s, the Tomahawk crews, the SS-20s. This is in 1987. But that treaty really marked the end of the Cold War 2 years before the fall of the Berlin Wall. Mm-hmm. So this is how that came into being. And then personally, I made reference to this effort to turn Boston Harbor into a nuclear weapons base, and that was what got me to Japan and into that. And it's, you know, I think John Lennon said, "Life is what happens when you're making other plans." Mm-hmm. I never really expected to become, if you will, an expert on nuclear weapons and disarmament. The reality is that the species, human beings, face two existential dangers right now. I mean, the possibility of eliminating all life and civilization, and one is nuclear weapons, mm-hmm. And the other is the climate emergency. There have been periods of greater and lesser consciousness. I think the Oppenheimer film has helped to open discourse about nuclear weapons again, and growing fears and concerns. The both the atomic scientists, they have their doomsday clock since 1957, and it's now set at 90 seconds to midnight, the closest we've ever come to annihilation. I wish I would have been able to come up with a formula as creative as Randy Forsberg's freeze, which could catalyze popular action. But we do have one model right now, called Back from the Brink here in the United States, and it's a effort to win organizations and city councils and state governments support for essentially five demands. One calling for implementation of the commitment to negotiate the abolition of nuclear weapons. I mean, the reality, but when people hear about the treaty on the nuclear non-proliferation treaty, they think all this means is no other countries get them. Mm-hmm. But if you look at that treaty, it's a bargain between the nuclear weapon states and the non-nuclear weapon states. And the non-nuclear weapon states said, we won't get them, in exchange for engaging in good faith negotiations for the complete elimination of your arsenals. So the first call is to fulfill that obligation. And then there are several ways of looking.
I mean, that's Article 6 of the NPT.
Article 6, that's correct. And then there are other steps which are more to reduce the danger, including de-alerting, which is to take the nuclear weapons off the missiles, so there's less likelihood of a accidental or miscalculated nuclear war. Calls for halting the spending of $1.7 trillion to replace the entire nuclear arsenal, which we're doing now over the course of 30 years. It calls for not deploying the ICBMs, so-called Sentinel missiles, across the Midwest, which are the land-based and the most vulnerable, the most useless, and maybe the most dangerous of the arsenal. There's one other dimension there as well. So that's something that's being pursued. We have now. And it's just to say, Congressman McGovern, who I think represents your part of the world, He's introduced legislation, HR 77, to move to implement Back from the Brink. And at last count, I think there were 43 members of Congress who had supported it. So we're building, but we don't have the kind of, at the moment, I mean, with the country engaged in this almost unimaginable election, where on the one hand, we have a choice between a would-be dictator and listen to Trump, what he says, and then better believe it. And on the other hand, a war president. So we're in a hard time here. And we've got the wars in Gaza, the wars in Ukraine. So not to mention, what's going on at the shopping mall. So there's a lot of distractions that keep people from doing what we need to do to preserve this and future generations.
Now, you wrote a book called Deadly Connection. And by that, you meant the relationship between nuclear weapons and, let's say, U.S. policy. So in your view, what are the objectives of U.S. nuclear arms policies?
So, first of all, I think what's missing in this society is a clear understanding of what our country is, how it became what it is. In a number of textbooks, at least when I was a kid, it described the period of 1898 to 1900 as the imperial age, mm-hmm. When the United States began creating an overseas empire. That's when the United States conquered Cuba, Puerto Rico, gained control of the Caribbean, and thus of much of Latin America. And at the same time, because there had been a Great Depression in the 1890s, which coincided with the building of a navy to rival Britain's, there was in this depression, unemployment, workers upset, protests. So the power elite here, including some from Massachusetts, thought that the best way to get out of it was to get a share of the China market, which would be if we could get the China market, we could have our factories running 24/7. Workers would be pleased and happy to be working, and there'd be big profits. So to do that, the United States conquered the Philippines and Samoa and Guam. So we need to understand that that was the foundation of a U.S. empire. And with the war in the Pacific was very different from the war in Europe in the Second World War. In the Pacific, it was a war between competing empires, the United States, Britain, and Japan. Japan wanted to take hold of the whole melon. But coming out of that, the Pacific Ocean became what's called an American lake. See if I've got the book by that title. I had it here, Andy, a little bit ago. We were the dominant power across Asia, and the tensions with China because they don't want to be dominated. So to understand that the U.S. I mean, we created the UN system, we created the International Monetary Fund, NATO, all these things to kind of maintain an empire, which is not exactly the same as the British Empire or the French Empire or the Russian Empire, but we have an empire. And there have been times when we've sought to defend that empire and times when we've sought to expand that empire. And what you understand is that, again, going back to history that most people don't know, people like General Eisenhower, the War Secretary Stimson, others in the top leadership of the United States in 1945, were advising Truman that the war against Japan was essentially won. It was essentially defeated. We didn't need nuclear weapons to end the war. And what you find is that the determinative reason for using the A-bombs was to bring the war to an immediate end in order to keep the Soviet Union from having influence in northern China, Manchuria, and Korea, all goals which failed. And in fact, those bombs did not end the war, although it happened coincidentally with it. What led the Japanese to do the immediate surrender was Russia's, the Soviet Union's, entry into the war on August the 8th, the day before the Nagasaki bomb. But if you read like Truman's diaries, what you find is that he said even before the bomb was detonated, when he was in Potsdam, was that with the atomic bomb, he'd have a hammer over those boys, meaning Stalin and his circle. And the idea was that these weapons could be used to enforce, they called the Grand Area, the U.S. Empire. And it began as early as 48. During the war, the United States and the Soviets were allies. And the United States had used Iran as a transmission belt to get weapons to the Soviets to fight Hitler. Mm-hmm. And when the war was over and the Russians were slow to leave, and the U.S. wanted to have greater influence in Iran, and there's a whole other history that you know very well there, Truman called the Soviet ambassador into the White House and said, if you don't begin the withdrawal within 48 hours, you'll lose Moscow. Mm-hmm. The withdrawal began within 24 hours. And so what you see is that, and I work closely with Daniel Ellsberg, Daniel Ellsberg is best known for the Pentagon Papers, but he was also the prime author of the U.S. nuclear warfighting doctrine under President Kennedy. Mm-hmm. And what I learned from him was that after Hiroshima and multiple international crises and wars, the U.S. has used its nuclear arsenal in the same way that an armed robber uses his gun, mm-hmm. pointing at someone's head. Whether or not the trigger is pulled, the gun has been used. And Noam Chomsky put it a different way, drawing on testimony by Secretary of Defense Brown in the Carter administration, was the U.S. has used its nuclear weapons to help ensure that no other nation would come to the aid of a country that we were determined to attack. Mm-hmm. So we did it many times in relationship to Korea, in relationship to Vietnam, in relationship to the Middle East, even Guatemala. And what we see now with Putin and Medvedev's nuclear threats is it's the same game, right? Basically saying, NATO, you keep out of Ukraine, because if you don't, we'll use nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. And we've had similar threats. I mean, Israel in the 73 war made the threats. France and Britain have made threats in different wars and crises. And we face a real danger where we have very limited bit of leverage and between India and Pakistan. Mm-hmm. So this is part of the world that we live in. Most people don't want to think about it, but this is where we are. To understand that the power of the United States, it's maintaining its empire, is dependent, on the threat of eliminating human life. I mean, it's mind-boggling. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you're familiar with writings of John Bellamy Foster for Month Review. Recently, he wrote that the U.S. after the collapse of Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War shifted towards a counter-force strategy rather than a counter-value strategy. Now, counter-value strategy was the strategy that basically led to the doctrine of MAD, mutually assured destruction, because the adversaries were targeting each other's cities, and the thought that millions of people will perish as a result of pursuing, let's say, military or political objectives was anathema, apparently, to let's say, political elites of either side. Now, since the end of the Cold War, John Bellamy Foster argues that there's been a counterforce revolution, which meant that the United States is now thinking in terms of targeting the nuclear forces and command centers of the adversaries in order to prevent them from any kind of retaliatory capability, using first strike, thinking. Mm-hmm. This kind of counterforce strategy was, according to him, was thought up briefly during Kennedy administration, John Kennedy's administration, but then was abandoned thereof quickly. But now you're returning to that. Are you familiar with this argument? Have you followed this counterforce versus countervalue strategies?
I think I learned about counterforce and countervalue when I was an undergraduate at Georgetown. I mean, these concepts have been out there from the beginning. And, you know, the U.S. has always pursued a first strike threat. Mm-hmm. You know, with the Tomahawk cruise and the Pershings of what, the 1979 and into the 80s, it was designed to wipe out the Soviet command. I mean, basically in 8 minutes, the idea was, but 8 minutes, you can wipe out the Soviet leadership in Moscow. Of course, you take out a lot more than that as well. And I you know, counterforce is certainly still there. You know, it's interesting thinking about Joe Biden. Mm-hmm. In 2017, as he's leaving office, vice president, he's saying that, you know, the sole use of nuclear weapons should be for deterrence, second strike. But you know, when he came to do his nuclear posture review with the Pentagon, it's interesting. Dan Ellsberg was predicting that he wouldn't end the U.S. first strike doctrine and policy because that's the only way that the U.S. could conceivably prevent China from taking Taiwan if it wanted. So Taiwan is one of the reasons why we still have that first strike doctrine. Mm-hmm. I'm not close enough to be able to say what it is at the moment, so I don't want to go where I can't. Okay. But what I do know is that very well respected international climate scientists, in contract with the Physicians for Social Responsibility, have done several studies on what the impact of use of nuclear weapons would be. I mean, on one hand, if you're using hydrogen bombs, you're way beyond counterforce because of just the devastation that it creates over, you know, a wide area, and then the radioactive fallout. So, you know, hydrogen bombs directed at New York are going to wipe out New England. So much for counterforce. But the other piece is that these studies that have been done by climate scientists show us that even a comparatively small nuclear exchange of, say, 50 to 100 nuclear weapons, say, between India and Pakistan, in addition to those it immediately kills and poisons, there'll be fires, massive fires. And with the fires will come smoke, and the smoke will spread over the planet. And with the use of just 50 to 100 nuclear weapons, you have smoke clouds, more than clouds, it's just a new layer in the atmosphere that will block the sun, lead to global cooling, lead to collapse of agriculture in the Northern Hemisphere, and the death of up to 2 billion people. So the idea of fighting a limited nuclear war, and this is also what the Russians have been threatening in Ukraine, is suicidal. Mm-hmm. And the other piece that we don't think much about is the dynamics of, on the one hand, well, two dynamics. One, the fact that presidents or prime ministers don't fully control their arsenals. And the other is the danger of escalation. So, for example, in the Cuban Missile Crisis, and the United States had overwhelming nuclear superiority in relationship to the Soviets. In that, one of the senior generals who had authority to do so, contrary to Kennedy's policy, escalated the level of nuclear threat in the way that the Russians could see it, and we could not. And thus increasing the danger of the use of nuclear weapons. You had at a period when Kennedy wanted Khrushchev to have some peace and quiet to think about a peace proposal. Kennedy ordered that U.S. destroyers in the Caribbean should not use depth bombs, depth charges against Russian submarines. Well, if you're in the Navy, what better chance to practice using depth charges than right then? And so they did. They violated orders. One of the Soviet submarines was taking on serious blows. Depth charges were cutting off the supply of oxygen within the submarine. It had nuclear torpedoes. Soviet doctrine at that time was that they could only launch their nuclear weapons if all three commanding officers agreed. In that moment, two of them said, use them or lose them. But the third said no. Thus, we're still alive. So you have this. There's also a mistaken launch order in the middle of the crisis sent to Okinawa. And fortunately, the officer there just disregarded it. A courageous guy. And we've had similar things with, you know, with Russians, as Colonel Peskov was responsible for sending the notice to the Russian Soviet military that it was under attack when missiles were coming in. And the computers this one morning were showing that the missiles were coming in. He decided not to believe it, didn't send the order. Thus we didn't go to nuclear war. And he was demoted for not following orders. So you have this set of dangers. The other is the possibility of political forces. In the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis, and Kennedy had, you know, it's interesting. The whole thing was unnecessary, right? I mean, when we first detected that the Russians were putting nuclear weapons into Cuba, Secretary of Defense McNamara initially said, just let it go. Within 10 years, the Russians are going to have enough nuclear weapons anyhow. It won't make a difference. He switched in the course of the crisis and was advocating invasion of Cuba when they already had missiles deployed. To get back where I'm going with this, you have political forces. So at one point in this crisis, President Kennedy turns to his brother and says, if we hadn't moved to implement the blockade and to escalate this crisis, I would have been impeached. Well, you have similar political forces at play in China, in Russia, in India. And so in a crisis, political forces could move people to do the unthinkable. So we need to understand just how deep the dangers are here.
No, absolutely. Now, going back to the counterforce, you know, my understanding of it is, since you said if you use hydrogen bomb, then it doesn't really make sense because it blows everything apart. But my understanding of counterforce is that it involves a continuum of weaponry, from conventional weapons to tactical nuclear weapons.
The whole base, yeah.
The non-strategic, like nuclear weapons, all the way to the hydrogen bomb. And the whole idea, I think, behind it is to make nuclear weapons usable again in some strategic thinking and integrate it, you know, into the... is integrate the nuclear weapons into the military strategy of the United States, since we are in the unipolar moment.
Let me push back with two things on that. My friend Michael Clare, who is the military correspondent for The Nation, was just out in California, where he was observing war games between the United States and China. The purpose of that war game, as he explained it, was to demonstrate that the United States has overwhelming conventional abilities and China shouldn't bother. But as he said, he found it unthinkable, and the war game didn't even begin to approach the possibility that China might respond with nuclear weapons, and on you go. We're also in this new world of AI. We're in the world of cyber hacking. So clearly efforts are being made in developing systems along that line. It's interesting, the Chinese, I've been involved in some symposium with the U.S. and Chinese physicists and the strategic thinkers. One of the things the Chinese have been asking for is negotiations with the United States to create guarantee systems that would prevent either side from using cyber capabilities in their command and control systems. You know, the idea there is if you could disable a country's ability to launch a nuclear war, then you've got them totally you have total control over them. So clearly this is going on, but the idea of containing nuclear war, this has been the ambition of many of the nuclear priesthood for years. But the world is dynamic. Others don't lay over and make it easy for you.
What is the primary argument made by those who are objecting to, let's say, abolition or reduction of nuclear weapons to absolute minimum for maintenance of these weaponry? I mean, in the past, I know it was like deterrence, you know, the idea of MAD and all that. But what is it now? I mean, your post-90s, the multiplicity.
It's still deterrence. The idea, and it's interesting, if you go back, you can see it in the Oppenheimer film. If you go back to the origin of the U.S. nuclear weapons, the fear was that the Germans would beat us to it. And the idea was that if we could build a nuclear weapon before the Germans did, that we could deter them from using nuclear weapons in the war. It turns out as early as 1942, we learned that the Germany was not going to be able to make a nuclear weapon in time for the war. And at that point, although Japan became the target, the real target of the weapons was Russia. So something that General Groves told to Joseph Rotlap, who was one of the senior scientists there on his arrival. So it remains deterrence. I mean, the Pakistanis have their nuclear arsenal to deter India. India has its nuclear arsenal to deter China. The U.S. has its nuclear arsenal primarily to deter China and Russia, and on it goes. The difficulty with deterrence is it only works until it doesn't. We've had a number of, as I indicated before, a number of close calls. I mean, there's a book, Command and Control, which runs through the number of nuclear weapons accidents and the dangers we've come when. Mm-hmm. When the systems fail, so deterrence is the primary rationale, mm-hmm. and it certainly has become a function of the nuclear arsenal, mm-hmm. But it's had this other purpose, which the U.S. has practiced over these many times, with preparations, threats to initiate nuclear war. Now we see the Russians doing it in Ukraine.
I mean, the other argument would be an argument that there's an inner logic to this defense or military systems anyway, technological innovations, is an industrial system. Maybe the U.S. economy will just go into depression, sure, if you get rid of like the military industrial complex and all,
sure,
that.
Sure.
Just the bureaucratic momentum, the technological innovations, the connection to the civil economy, all of those things adds to the maintenance.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Absolutely.
And then there is the political leadership and the pursuit of global hegemony and objectives of U.S. empire. All of those things are layers added to these things, aren't they?
I mean, we're dealing with an onion whose skins are all interrelated, right? Mm-hmm. You go back to its early use in the U.S. Truman thought he had the weapon that would make it possible to rule the world, mm-hmm. But then other systems grow up around it, right? Mm-hmm. So you have the nuclear weapons labs, and you've got the suppliers, and then you've got, as you were saying, the military industrial complex, which provides in the area of where television and the cost of television ads become so central to, mm-hmm. election campaigns. You've got your members of Congress and those challenging them who need to raise a lot of money. So they're going to take money from the weapons makers. Even where you have progressives, they are taking money. And how many members of Congress have you seen who said, we don't want the Pentagon jobs in our district? I mean, it's a whole very nasty system, requires a kind of a paradigm breakthrough, mm-hmm. beginning to think about the world that we need and beginning to do, you know, multiple levels of change, right? I mean, on the one level, diplomatic negotiations, on the other hand, person to person, on the other hand, arts, and just a whole range of social change. I mean, when I was at Georgetown 9 million years ago, it's interesting. We had this course the first year called The Evolution of Civilization. It was taught by a professor, Quigley, who was basically competing with Toynbee. Mm-hmm. And Bill Clinton was in that class. And Quigley taught, he was going to flunk you, even if you had all the appropriate information. If you didn't, in a question about analyzing a civilization, if you didn't structure it around six interrelated dimensions of the civilization and power, military, economic, political, social, intellectual, and spiritual. And so just as our systems are based on those interrelated structures, changing it has to be worked through all those structures.
There is a lunatic aspect, to this institutional development, which is if you have a situation of, let's say, parity, nuclear parity in the world, or if you have multiplicity of governments and states that are nuclear armed, there's nine of them as far as we know. Now you're led into this idea of deterrence based on resolve, based on demonstration of credibility of your resolve to threat, with the threat of the threatening to the use of this weapon. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Then you can also add your buildup of nuclear weaponry and massive military budget to demonstrate that you are resolved. You do have this credible threat. Mm-hmm. So this is kind of like the institutional lunacy that I can see coming out of this sort of situation. The other thing is I came across this quote from memoirs of President Eisenhower. He said this is from 1963, Mandate for Change, his book. Mm-hmm. He says, my feeling was then, during the Korean War, and still remains, that it would be impossible for the United States to maintain the military commitments which it now sustains around the world without turning into a garrison state, did we not possess atomic weapons and the will to use them when necessary.
Yeah,
so it poses the question, okay, U.S. military commitments exist. We have, some people have called it an empire of bases, with 800 plus maybe military bases. Now, is it still relevant, his observation, that in order to maintain our military commitments globally, we cannot avoid nuclear weapons?
Well, technology changes. Mm-hmm. So it's possible that cyber and AI technology might in time serve as at least an additional system that would sufficiently terrorize any other nation, mm-hmm. not to challenge what the U.S. wants. I mean, it's interesting. Eisenhower in the post-war period wanted to invest in, he wanted to build the economy, mm-hmm. and he couldn't do that while maintaining a conventional military with the ability to intervene in any country and dominate any country at any time. And so that tilted him in the direction of what you just quoted here, the creation of a nuclear arsenal to defend the empire, called at the time the grand area. And it's worth noting that when he ran for president in 52, the Korean War was in a stasis at that point. The lines were drawn. And there were negotiations over the release of POWs. And the North Koreans and Chinese wanted more of their prisoners released than the U.S. was willing to give in exchange for U.S. prisoners. Mm-hmm. So in the campaign, Eisenhower said he had a secret plan for how to end the Korean War. And then when it came to power, he moved to implement it, which was to say he very quietly communicated the threat that we'd use nuclear weapons unless they would agree to our terms, mm-hmm. which they did. And that in turn provided the model for Nixon in 69 when he did his madman threat, mm-hmm. and put the U.S. nuclear forces on a massive, massive nuclear war for 29 days which included even putting nuclear weapons in civilian airports like Logan here in Boston. So it was multiple purposes here for the arsenal.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you call in your book nuclear extortion. That's an example.
Yeah, exactly. The other thing to say, which is complicated matters now, you know, there are consequences for missing opportunities. So, in Reykjavik, Gorbachev and Reagan met, and they came to an agreement to eliminate their nuclear arsenals, which then Baker and others pushed back on, and Reagan held out for Star Wars, which implied the ability to destroy any of their weapons while we could have ours. So we lost that opportunity. So now we're in a world where China is moving beyond its minimum deterrent arsenal of 200 or so, probably has about 500 nuclear weapons now, and maybe seeking to gain parity. Not that you need it to destroy the world, but they're looking to do that. So we're in an increasingly dangerous situation here. And would that our faculty in our universities and our political science professors and our scientists spend a bit more of their energies trying to come up with a paradigm similar or equivalent to Randy Forsberg's freeze, so we could have a way to try to build this down and back.
Now we have about maybe a minute or two left, so I'm going to have my last comment and have you comment on it quickly. And that is, you know, in the preface to your book, Empire and the Bomb, the Filipino sociologist Walden Bello uses the term grand destabilizer for, weapons, nuclear weapons and all that. Now, do you think that the U.S. or the world's trajectory of new weaponry is going to go even into the space and nuclearize the space? I mean, United States command and the command structure is like a triad, you know, submarines and, you know, jets and ICBMs. But do you think that the space is going to be nuclearized as well?
Well, thus far, we don't have nuclear weapons as such based in space. But the communications functions for nuclear war and for conventional war are in space. So in many ways, you know, it is already a fourth dimension. You will note just last month, fears raised that the Russians would deploy nuclear weapons in space. They seem to be backing off of it. But the idea that any country can gain security by threatening other rivals doesn't work. It leads to spiraling arms races and wars. And that's why we advocate common security and common security diplomacy, building back, identifying what most threatens the country, engaging in negotiations, win-win negotiations with its rivals to reduce the fears on both sides and to build down. And that I think is the value, the core value that we have to be building on.
Well, I want to thank you for joining us in this discussion, joining me in this discussion, and let's hope for wisdom when it comes to this matter. Otherwise, I don't know, future looks dim.
Yes, yeah, wisdom and will. And thank you very much. I've enjoyed this conversation, even if it's on a tough, grim subject.
Thank you so much.
Be well.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.